All right, good morning. Are you excited to be here today?
Yes.
All right, Graves is excited to be here, and there's someone over there that's excited to be here. That guy right over there, I love it. Mr. Latrell, yeah, he's excited to be here. Are the rest of you excited to be here today?
Yes.
Now I know you're excited to be here today. Hey, you just want to take a moment to say welcome. We're excited you're here today. We're glad you're here today. Excited that we have an opportunity to worship God today. If you're visiting with us, a special welcome to you. We'd love to know you're here. If you're first time with us, second time, doesn't matter. If we don't know who you are, please take a moment to fill out the little connection card that you received when you came in. There's a little handout you got, and inside there's a connection card. Take a moment to fill that out, and on your way out the door today, on your out through the garage door there's a connection table. It's a high table sitting over against the window in the cafe area. Drop that in a basket right there. There'll also be someone sitting there that will be happy to answer some questions for you. If you have some questions about Northbridge, if you don't want anyone to talk to you, that's cool too. You can just drop it and just bolt. That's cool too. So, but again, we're excited you're here. Hey, there's a scripture that I wanted to bring to your attention. Do we have that, Brenda? Put that up there. That's what I woke up to this morning. I turned on my phone, and that was the verse that was on my phone. It's Psalms 47, verse 1. It says, "Come, everyone, clap your hands, shout to God with a joyful praise." Man, we have an opportunity to praise and to worship an amazing God today. And in just a moment, you're going to have an opportunity to clap your hands if you want and shout out in song if you want to. But if you're visiting with us, you want to just sit there and just kind of hang out and watch everyone else do that, that's cool too. But we have a great opportunity today. So I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet and greet some people around you, and then we'll get going in just a moment.
Thank you.
and shake and crumble. At your name, the oceans roar and tumble. At your name.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. Have tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Sing that again. There's nothing worth more.
God is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Father God, we praise you for all that you are. We thank you for the gift of your Spirit. We thank you for meeting with us here in this place. Lord, may that heart of worship, that heart of praising you for all that you are, and thanking you for all that you've given us, I pray that goes on throughout the rest of the day, throughout the rest of the week. Lord, that you will give us a heart of praise constantly. Lord, right now I pray that your Spirit will continue on in the service, that you'll be with Dave as he brings your words. And Father, I pray that each and every one of us in this room will be open and receptive to the message you have for us. We praise your name. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, that gave us the ability to pray. And it's in his name that we do pray. Amen.
You may be seated. Thanks, Lance. Thank you, worship team, for leading us this morning. Love that last song. You get caught up in just longing for the Holy Spirit to move not only in our lives, but also in this worship service. And it's always good to sing a song like that before we preach, before we speak, because, I mean, the Holy Spirit interacting with our worship, interacting with the Word of God, helps us to open our souls to what the Lord wants to teach us this morning. So that's a great thing. Great song. Just a couple of things I kind of want to warn you. Number one, I'm dealing with a deep chest cold today. So if I start hacking up here and phlegm flies everywhere, it's going to be okay, all right? No panicking. I'll try to direct it somewhere, not towards you, okay? But secondly, I just want to announce an event that's about to take place in the life of our church. Every year at Christmas time, we get the opportunity as a church family to be generous towards some foster kids in our community. And so on December 13th, we're going to gather back here and have a great time of fellowship Sunday night and pray over the gifts and all that good stuff. But this is what we get to do. We get to buy a gift for a foster child. Now, my right to your left in the very back, there's a table set up. And after service today, if you haven't had a chance to get there yet, Teresa's going to be back there, and she's going to help you pick out and select a foster kid that you might give a gift to. I went back to the day and got Adeline. Adeline, 2 years old. I can't wait. I love doing this every year. I get to go out, and all she wants is Frozen princess stuff. So that should be fun for me, right, in the Walmart aisle, picking up Frozen stuff. So I'm happy to do that for Adeline. And this also gives you an opportunity over the next few weeks to pray for that child, that God would be just unbelievably gracious to that child, and pray that God will allow that child to be adopted. So it's just not only about giving a gift, right, and going out shopping for a child. It's also for a few weeks while that letter is in your hand, that notification is in your hand, you can also pray that God would just be unbelievably generous to that child. This morning, the passage that we're going to be studying out of is in Luke chapter 12. So if you have a copy of God's Word, Luke 12, if you're new to Christianity, it's the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, and then Luke, third gospel in Matthew, Mark, Luke chapter 12, and we'll just be focusing on a teaching of Jesus. Let me just say this. What I'm about to tell you is the truth, and it's kind of embarrassing to some regards, but it's the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. When I was 18 years old, my first foray into gambling was a bingo hall, right? Has anyone in here ever been to a bingo hall in their life? May I just see the, oh my goodness, that's a lot. That's more than I thought. I forgot to ask that question in the first service. But 18 years old, this is back in the 1980s. This is weird. So my dad, you know, he was divorced and began to date. And one of the ladies that he began to date, he invited me on his first date. So let me just say this. It's not a good thing that on the first date you choose to bring your 18-year-old kid with you, all right? That doesn't work out too well. So she chooses, again, this is true. She chooses their first date to go to the bingo hall, right? So here we go to the bingo hall. Never played bingo outside of, you know, family night. You get around and have a little board and You play bingo, right? What, you know, you play for peanuts or popcorn, whatever. So I get to the bingo hall, and it was like this, you know, VFW post, some out in the middle of nowhere. And back in the 80s, you could smoke, and no one cared about your lungs and all that good stuff. So you walk in the bingo hall, and it was just this blanket of smoke, right? And you have people sitting up in their long tables, and they have their little gidgets and gizmos, and they have their little dot, their dot thingamajig, and they have these little figurines on surrounding them. You know, I think those are good luck tokens, and you walk in, right? Oh, you guys know what I'm talking about. So you walk in, and my dad pays for my stack of bingo cards, and then we find a spot, and we go to town. And let me tell you something, that first week I cleaned up the house, right? Had no idea how to do this, but that night I won $1,000. And I was like, woo-hoo. I mean, 1980s, $1,000 was a lot of money, right? And I was like, I was so excited, pumped up, you know? And so the next week, guess where the lady wanted to go for her second date? That's right, the bingo hall. And guess what? I asked my dad, can I go along? And sure, come along with us. And went back the second week, and lo and behold, same VFW, right? Never been gambling before in my life. 18 years old, cleaned up the next week. I won it all. There was this little game that you play at the end, the big jackpot, where you have to black out every single dot on your card. I don't know what you call it. Anyone have a name for it? I don't know what the name of it is. Anyways, cleaned up jackpot, $1,500. Let me just say this. Those old people were not happy with this guy coming in their place and taking all their money. And I don't know what happened. I don't know if someone grabbed my dad afterwards and threatened him with his life by saying, never come back here again. I don't know, but my dad would never let me go back to the bingo hall, right? And I'm glad, because this is what I told my dad. I said, man, if I can just go back one more time, I'm only $500 away from being able to buy a car. Back then, you could buy a car for $3,000 that could actually run on four wheels. And I said, man, I need one more time out there. I mean, one more time. And my dad was like, absolutely not. You're not going back to play bingo. You know, you're going to go out and you're going to work for that last $500. At the time, I was working at McDonald's. I'm thinking, okay, a couple of hours in the bingo hall, I mean, I made more money than I could have ever worked in, you know, for a whole year working at McDonald's back then. But I'm glad my dad did that, because it put an end to what could have been a very disastrous life ahead of me. I mean, I could have become the bingo king of America, more than likely, I'm sure, right? But it began and ended there. And I'm so glad, because, you know what, I didn't realize this at the time, but looking back on that moment, I had become addicted to getting rich. There's something about going out and winning money and getting money very quickly that just gets into your system, and you're like, man, it's like this high. I just can't get enough. I can't get enough. And that's what was going on in my life. But I'm glad my dad said, no, here's the way you need to go about it. You need to work for what you want to get. Isn't that so true? I mean, we're all about, how do I get what I don't have and get it quickly? It's only, if I only had this, Dad, if I only had $500 more, Dad, if I could only go back one more time, if only. And that's kind of the driving motive of our hearts sometimes. We really want what others have, or we really want what we think is going to make us happier in life. See, we're creatures driven by comfort. Everything in our life is about what brings comfort and what brings stability to our own lives. That's why we go out and we work hard. Many of you not only work one job, you work two jobs. And you're working, you know, 60-plus hours a week, because you want to provide for your family. You want your family to be comfortable. You want your kids and your wife to have what you never had growing up. You want to be a good provider for your family. And so you go out there and you work hard and you hustle, and you, by the sweat of your brow, you have what you have because you've genuinely worked hard for that. And let me tell you, that's a great thing. That's a good thing to have a great work ethic and want to strive to be your very best and want to strive to provide and have all the comforts of life. There's nothing wrong with that. In fact, the scriptures doesn't teach us that it's wrong to have those things in our life. But what happens when this desire to have things begins to take over our lives? What happens when comfort is just not enough for you? But you want more than comfort. I hear that whistle. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Talk to me afterwards. I know that was a cell phone. I just wanted to break the tension right there. So so what do we do? What do we do when that desire for more and more and more begins to take place, and before you know it, you begin to derail your life because it's all about accumulation. It's all about wealth. It's all about more and more possessions. And so that's what Jesus is getting at today. He's not talking about wealth is bad and shame on you for wanting things. No, he's talking about the heart of a darker issue, and that is what happens when greed begins to take hold of our life. And so he begins to tell a parable in Luke chapter 12, a parable. Now, a parable is just a made-up story with a moral attribute or a moral saying attached to it, a moral truth attached to it. And if Jesus was alive today in our day and age, he would have started off this parable with once upon a time, right? Once upon a time, there was a rich man, and he did not live happily ever after. And Luke 12, 1, it kind of indicates to us what was going on in Jesus' life and ministry. It was almost at the apex of his ministry. People by the thousands were flocking to him. In fact, in that moment where he was teaching along a hillside, it said thousands of people had gathered around us. In fact, it was more than that. It was just an out-of-control crowd. It says that they were stepping on one another. I mean, Jesus was the rock star of his day as he was going around the wilderness aspect of Judea. I mean, this was no Kiwanis Club meeting in the back of a library type of meeting where everyone was on their best behavior. I mean, it was bedlam. It was like, you know, a mall full of teenage girls with a sighting of Taylor Swift somewhere in the mall, right? It was 100% bedlam. People crawling over one another. People reaching out and wanting to get close to Jesus. They wanted to be touched by Jesus. They wanted to touch him. They wanted to be healed by him. And it was one of those kind of environments that was going on. And Jesus is teaching, and people are listening to him. And then something happens. And we've all been in those situations before. Something happens, and someone says something, and it kind of just sucks all the energy out of the room, right? That's exactly what happened in this moment. For in this crowd, a guy speaks up. I mean, Jesus is in a sweet spot of his message, of his teaching time. And this guy yells out. In fact, Luke points it out in Luke chapter 12, verse 13. He says, someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Man, who appointed me a judge or arbiter over you?" Now, I love Jesus' reactions, God. It's just almost like, you know, he didn't see it coming, but we know Jesus, he knows all things. And so even though it may seem like he didn't see it coming, we know that he saw it coming somehow. So this guy stands up and he says something totally stupid, totally off, you know, off the beaten path of what Jesus was talking about. And he said, "Hey, Jesus, I got an issue here." "Well, what's your issue?" "Tell my brother, give me what's due to me," basically. And so Jesus' reaction is hilarious. This is the only time in the gospel accounts that Jesus addresses someone by the title man. In other words, Jesus was saying, "Dude, come on. Are you kidding me? I mean, you're going to interrupt my message for this?" And the man's heart was so focused on that one thing. That was the man's need in that very moment. That man thought that his brother was taking advantage of him, and he wanted what he believed was due to him. You see, that one opportunity that man had in his life, this is what I'm convinced of. If it was just, if that greed was just about that one man, if that one man just struggled with that notion of wanting what he didn't have, why would Jesus spend any more time on that issue? Unless Jesus knew that even though that guy kind of spoke up in an inappropriate moment, he took it and he said, "I'm going to take something that this one man spoke from his heart in front of this whole crowd because I know that not only he struggles with it, but all of us struggle with this notion of greed." And so Jesus said, "Man, who appointed me a judge or arbiter over you?" There's more to this life. There's more to this life than what you really want me to fix. You see, this man just wanted this temporary fix in his life. And Jesus is not about giving us temporary fixes. He's about the issues of our soul. And so he begins to dig in, and he says this in verse 15. He says, beware and be on your guard against every form of greed. For not even when one has an abundance does his life consist of his possessions. Beware, right? And be on your guard. In other words, Jesus is telling us that if we don't watch ourselves, greed can overtake our lives. Why would he say, beware and be on guard against every form of greed that's out there? Well, I can only think of three things. One, just by taking this man's situation, greed has disrupted his relationship with his brother. And that's exactly what greed will do in our lives. It will disrupt relationships. And we will sometimes allow money and allow possessions to cause envy, to cause strife, to cause disagreement, to even cause estrangement against those that we love. I mean, how many families, and maybe your family is one of them, that there has been a disagreement that has erupted over a relative that left a will behind, and some people in your family got some money, and maybe you and some other people didn't get any money. I mean, has that not caused strife sometimes in family? Haven't families broken apart over left behind possessions? Absolutely. How many partnerships have gone sour over the years when one partner in a business wants more and more than the other partner? One partner wants 75% of the company and will only give the other partner 25% of the company, even though you put in the same amount of equity and capital into that partnership, into that business. And so greed is always can always come in and impact relationships, and many times those relationships become irreparable, irreplaceable even, because we're all consumed by getting what we think we deserve. Secondly, greed causes us to put more emphasis on possessions than it does people. And when it comes to greed, it leads you to get whatever you want to get by any means possible. That it gets you whatever you want to get, no matter what you will do to get it, or no matter who stands in your way that you have to destroy in order to get it. Sometimes greed just clouds the very fact that Jesus says, and the Bible even proves it, and by saying people are always more important than possessions. If you don't believe me in that, just in a couple weeks from now, we're going to have Black Friday erupt, right? And what takes place on Black Friday is sad. Every year you'll be sitting down to, you know, the next day after Christmas, and next day after Thanksgiving, and you'll be watching on TV screens people acting insane, right? I mean, it's people who are normal, everyday, wonderful people every other day of the year, but Black Friday has done something in our culture. It drives people nuts, drives people crazy. People line up for days waiting to get that flat screen TV, and before you know it, when those doors open up, you know, people charge in, run over everybody, punch, scream, grab, kick, you know, pull hair, whatever it takes, shooting sometimes people in order to get, you know, that item that's on discount. You know, is it really worth it? I remember my first thought on Black Friday was, this was back in the early 80s, and my sister really wanted a Cabbage Patch doll. Remember, if you were alive back in the 80s, remember the Cabbage Patch craze? I mean, they were going for thousands of dollars. And listen, we were poor. My mom was a single mom raising us back then, and she didn't have a nickel to her name. But by God, because my sister wanted that Cabbage Patch doll, she was about to go out on Friday, get up early in the morning, go out there and stand in line for a Cabbage Patch doll. And she came back with scratches. I was like, Mom, what in the world did you do? And she was like, I was just grabbing for a Cabbage Patch doll, and someone ripped it out of my hands. I don't know what ever happened. I think my sister got a lettuce head or something like that. I think there was an off-brand of a Cabbage Patch doll. She didn't get what she wanted. But my mom, I mean, she did whatever she could to get that Cabbage Patch doll. Again, people do crazy things when it comes to greed in their life. And thirdly, it creates a distortion about what life is all about. It's not about accumulating wealth and possessions. This is not what life's all about. In fact, God is really wanting to get our attention on this matter. He devotes an entire book of the Bible in the Old Testament called Ecclesiastes. And that book is about King Solomon and his writing, his journaling at the end of his life. And he's looking back at his life. And King Solomon was one of the richest men to have ever lived. right? He had everything that he ever wanted in life. Anything that his eyes saw, it was his. He lived life to the fullest. He had all the right toys. He had all the right things. And in the end, he was sitting back going, you know what? It was all vanity. Everything that I looked for and longed for in my life, that's not what life is all about. He lived such a hedonistic life, and he thought in his hedonism, that was what was going to fulfill me. And in the end, he was saying, meaningless, meaningless, everything under the sun is meaningless. You see, why is that? Because the Bible gives teaches clearly that it's all about relationships and not possessions. And in fact, the greatest relationship that we could ever have in life is our relationship with our Heavenly Father. And sometimes greed, when it gets a hold of us, even tears apart of the fabrics of that relationship as well. So in verse 15, Jesus says, not even one who has abundance does his life consist of possessions. You know, you can be the wealthiest person out there, and you have everything you want to have in life, and it's still not enough. You can be the poorest out there and just struggle to make ends meet, and you can still struggle with greed because all you think about is, man, if I could just live like that person, or if I could have just that one thing, or if I could be at this level of wages, man, and when I'm at that wage, I can make it and I'll be very happy. You know, we all struggle no matter what socioeconomics, you know, status you have in life. We all struggle with this notion of greed. So what is greed? What is greed? Let me just give you a simple definition of greed. Greed is when you lust for more than you need. And that creates a never-ending, you know, unsatiable appetite for more. It's a desire to have more than you need in life. And not only that, is that you crave more and more and more and more things. It's what you think about all day long. Paul in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 5 says that greed is basically a form of idolatry. Why is that? Why would greed be a form of idolatry? It's because this, we have taken the focus of God, our Heavenly Father, off the top rung of our life, and we've replaced him with possessions. We've placed him with this desire to have more and more things. And so these things in our life, these possessions in our life, become this little G-God that we hunger for and search after, and it takes our emphasis off of our Heavenly Father. And so we struggle with these things in life. And so Jesus tells the story, and it's this once upon a time story, and he goes like this in verse 16. The land of a rich man was very productive. And he began reasoning to himself, saying, what shall I do since I have no place to store my crops? Then he said, this is what I will do. I will tear down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all of my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years to come. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your soul is required of you. And now who will own what you have prepared? So is the man who stores up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. Jesus addresses the issue of greed with an unlikely bunch. His disciples, if you read further in that passage, his disciples are just gathered around him. And these men are not wealthy. In fact, they're far from being wealthy. And he points out this teaching to them and tells them not to be greedy. Why? Because greedy is a pervasive sin, and Jesus cares for our souls. The poor, like I said before, struggle with greed. Causes those who have less to look at those who have more and want more in their life. Jesus points out in this very passage that the rich also are envious. They're not envious of other people. What they're envious for is they want more and more things. Their longing, their lusting in life is their possessions. Their identity is in their possessions and not necessarily in their status. So that's what the heart of the story is all about. How to identify greed and not how to live our lives without greed as a driving force within us. Now, if you look at the story, there's something interesting in this passage that I kind of want to bring out. Jesus says, this is what's the most important thing about life. What's the most important thing about life is this. It's number one, it has nothing to do with possessions, right? I love what Jesus says. He says this man's lands were bountiful. His lands were very productive. I think that's a key for us to understand, because this is what I kind of want to get out there and want everyone to understand. Because when we talk about money, when we talk about that kind of stuff, you get kind of, you know, you got this little tension that's running between me and you at this time. And this whole message is not about the fact you can't have things in life. That's not what we're getting at. In fact, when he says his lands were very productive, this is a means of saying to us, God was blessing this man. And God blesses us with things in life. God blesses us with possessions. He blesses us with wealth. And so wealth is not a negative thing. Wealth is not a bad thing. In fact, Jesus is not even coming close to even indicating that. Wealth is a very good thing. Wealth is a good thing in several regards. Well, with wealth, you can provide for your family. With wealth, you can set your children up for a better life when they start off as adults. With wealth, you can buy things you need in life. You can buy insurance and other things that out-of-pocket expenses would undo you for. Wealth generates jobs. You know, wealthy entrepreneurs that are out there, I mean, not only do they have these great ideas, but they formulated a way in which to help others also have an income. So you have that in life. So there's nothing bad about wealth. Wealth is a good thing. Wealth becomes bad when it becomes the 100% focus of our lives. You can use wealth, and this is what I love about wealth, and it's a factor of the gospel. You can use wealth to impact other people's lives who doesn't have anything. That's the wonderment of the gospel. The gospel frees us up to be generous towards other people. When I was doing some research for this message, I came across this website because I was just interested. What is the average income of the world? You know what, on a yearly basis? And this is what the website said: $9,800 is the average income of a person out there. So if you make more than $9,800, you are doing better than 50% of the population of this earth. Then it goes on to say, if you make $25,000 a year or more, then you are in the upper 2% of wealth in the world. Can you believe that? I mean, I was like, yeah. I mean, that is exciting. Dave Myers, 2%. Who knew? Who knew? If you make $34,000 a year, which, by the way, believe it or not, $34,000 a year is the median income of Springfield, Missouri. But if you make $34,000 a year, according to this website, you are in the upper 1% of wealth in the entire world. We are the 1%ers right here in this room. Who'd ever thought that, right? But you might push back on that by saying, listen, you know, I'm not living in the jungles of Africa, you know, where $34,000 could be like living like a king. I live in Springfield, Missouri, and I can barely afford, you know, a Happy Meal at McDonald's, right? So it's all about perspective. And it is about perspective. It's about us being having stewardship over what God has given us in this life. And this is what I think Jesus is trying to teach us. He goes back to what this man says in this passage. He reasons with himself and he says, what should I do? And that's the question that we all have to ask ourselves. With the possessions and the status in life, with the wealth that God has given us, or the income level that God has given us, what am I to do with what God has given me? Now, there was a guy named John D. Rockefeller. I don't know if you ever heard of him before, but that lived back in the 1800s, became the United States' first billionaire. By the end of his life, he was worth $30 billion. And so someone came up to him and said one day, hey, John, how much money do you want to make before you die? He says, just a little bit more, just a little bit more. And I think that that's the driving cause behind greed. It's just this accumulation of, I have enough money, I have more than enough for my needs, and I have more than enough for my wants, but I just need just a little bit more. Going back to Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 10, these are the words again from the richest man in the world, and he says, he who loves money will not be satisfied with money, nor he who loves abundance with its income. This too is vanity. When good things increase, those who consume them will increase. So we have So we have this notion in front of us from King Solomon. In other words, he's saying, when you get to that next level, when you increase your income, when you get more possessions in life, you just want more and more and more and more. Now, I want you to hear me out. Hear me out. Go out there and buy your house. Go and do it. Go out there and drive your nice truck. In fact, I encourage you, if you want a new truck, go out there and get your new truck. You know, we're Ford, conveniently located on Business 60 in Mountain Grove. I mean, look them up. I mean, they'll give you a great deal. This is not what Jesus is getting after. Jesus is getting after, can you steward your money well enough that you glorify me and you don't allow greed to interfere in your life? You see, Jesus turns around to his disciples and said, let me just tell you guys one thing. When you go out in this world, you're not going to be rich. In fact, you're going to be needy. You're going to be hungry at times. You're going to be scrounging around for a place to rest your head. But in the midst of all that, man, don't become greedy in life. Remember this: your Heavenly Father knows you. Your Heavenly Father knows your situation. He cares for you, and He will provide what you need in life. And so, for you and I, we need to understand: it's not about the possessions. It's not about getting all the big toys in life, right? It's not dying with everything in abundance. It's recognizing God's going to take care of you. And above and beyond what he takes care of you for, how are you to be generous with the stewardship of your wealth? Secondly, Jesus says life is not about possessions. He also says life is not about you. If you look back at the story, and I think, Brenda, we have this on the screen. If you look back at the story, count how many times this man uses the word I. And in the translation that I've used this morning, you can find he uses it 6 times. And I think 2 or 3 more times he uses the word my. Me, myself, and I. What's this all about for me? Me and my generation of more wealth. It wasn't for him to share with other people. His wealth was about him. It wasn't about the farmer next door that maybe didn't have a better field than he did. It was about him. There was nothing wrong with him tearing down his barns to house bigger barns to house more grain. There's nothing wrong with that. But what he was saying was, I want to house more grain because once I do that, I've hit it big time. I can sit back and enjoy life. I can eat and drink and be merry. In other words, I don't have a care in the world. Once I get this, it's all about me. In other words, he was looking to retirement. He was looking with a few years ahead of him, but he was not looking with eternity in mind. Let me say this too. There's nothing wrong with planning for your retirement. In fact, I think that's a smart, wise thing to do. Think about retirement. But this man was going above and beyond that. He was thinking about, man, it's going to be great one day where I can just lounge around the pool at the country club. I can go golfing all day. You know, I can sip adult beverages and just hang out with my friends. This is going to be a great, I can travel the world. It's going to be a great life. Again, I'm going to do all this. I'm going to increase my barns so I can have more money to spend on me. Like I said, there's nothing wrong with planning for your future. In fact, this past week, I cut a check for my retirement IRA fund, okay? I mean, it's a good thing, and it's good for us to look forward to that. But here's where the difference is. Can I put money aside for my IRA fund and still be generous to, a kid who's in the foster care system? Can I go out there and buy my truck from Weir Ford or my house and at the same time tithe and give towards my church? Can I just spend all my time just working my way up the corporate ladder till I get the top job and the corner office and the sweet income that comes along with it and all the benefits that come along with it and still be a part of taking the gospel around the world? I mean, that's what it's really all about. God did not call this man a fool because he had this possessions in these great barns. He called him a fool because he failed to see that he was not the captain of his soul. He was not the decider of his future. And he was not above accountability for his decisions. I mean, God was not in the picture for this man. Maybe it was at some point, but at this point where wealth had become everything. It became the driving force of his life. It became his little god. It became his idol. And he had to fulfill it in some way. He was a fool because he lived for self and was not generous towards others, nor did he ever give a thought, one thought, towards the God who blessed his fields abundantly. Sometimes we get so caught up in the affairs of the world that our passion, our love, our worship of God kind of takes a back seat to our greed, and that becomes everything we think about. So when Jesus says in verse 21, he says, this is what life's all about. If it's not about possessions, and if it's not about living for self, then this is what it's all about. He says this, so is the man who stores up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. You see, generosity towards God is what's most important in life. Now, how can you become generous towards God? Is generosity towards God that event that takes place in the drive-thru lane at Starbucks when you pay it forward? Hey, you know, I'll pay for that guy behind me. You know, give him the biggest red cup you got without Merry Christmas on it, right? Give it to him. Give it to him quick. No, that's not being generous towards God. That's just being generous. That's just being kind. That's just being gracious. That's just being good to somebody that you don't know. But that's not what graciousness towards God is all about. Being rich or gracious towards God is saying that your life is for his glory and not your comfort. In other words, you look and value living your life in such a way it brings honor and glory to your Heavenly Father. The second way we're rich towards God is that your soul satisfaction is in God alone and not in the possessions that he gives you. Yes, you can thank him for your possessions in life. You can thank him for your wealth. You can thank him for the house that you live in. You can thank him for the things you have in life and still worship him uttermost in your soul. That there's those things you have in your life, but then there is this great God that you worship and adore, and you're consumed with knowing him more and more in your life. And being rich towards God means that you don't allow anything in your life to take ownership of your soul outside of him. Being rich towards God is saying, God, I'm happy with what you've given me in life. I'm content with how things have borne out in my life. I'm content with, if you're poor, being poor. I'm content with being a poor, struggling college student. I'm content at middle age making, you know, $29,000 a month. I'm just content with what you're doing in my life. And if you can come to that point in your life, then you can open up your soul to being more gracious and generous towards your Heavenly Father. Because what you're saying is this, you don't put a stamp of approval and say, God, you must not love me because I don't have this. Or God, you must not love me because I have to struggle, you know, to make ends meet in my life. No, you're saying, God, in the midst of my struggle, in the midst of my longings, in the midst of my wants, you know, my unfulfilled wants, you are still king of my soul. And I worship you more than anything else in my life. Paul in 1 Timothy 6 gives some instructions to those who are rich. And again, listen, you may not think you're rich, but in many ways we are, right? We are blessed in this nation. Even those who are poor among us, we're still blessed, right? And this is what he says in 1 Timothy 6. Instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches. Isn't that wonderful, that phrase, uncertainty of riches? In other words, money comes and goes, right? We might have our good days, our good years. We might have our 2 weeks winning streak at the local bingo hall. And then there are times we just bust out in life, right? So uncertainty of riches, it comes and goes. It's fleeting. But there's one thing, Paul says, there's something very certain, and that is God himself. So fix your hopes not on the uncertainty of riches, but on God who richly supplies us with what? All things to enjoy. There it is, folks. Have a good Sunday afternoon, right? He says, enjoy what he has given you richly in your life. Instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, storing up for themselves a treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed. Again, generosity, showing your generosity in life. In other words, don't put money and wealth as a centerpiece and the focal point of your life. If you can come to a point in your life where you're satisfied where you're at and you're generous towards other people and you're generous towards God, then you understand that you have greed in check. But if you're just sitting there longing for more and more, and every day you get up and you're thinking, what can I do today? Can I win that Powerball jackpot? Oh man, if I just won that Powerball jackpot, I will be set for life. Is there scheming that takes place in your heart? What can I do to get more and more and more? And Jesus is warning us, you know, be on your guard. Beware. Let me just give you three things to look to see if you struggle with greed. Number one, am I content with my present condition? Yes or no? It's a yes or no question. Am I content in my present condition? Number two, do I rejoice in or do I resent others around me that are more prosperous than myself? Do I resent or do I rejoice in those around me that are more prosperous than myself? Yes or no? Am I discontent with what I have? Am I discontent with what I have? Yes or no? These are some of the questions we have before us today to say, hey, has greed really taken hold of your heart? I just think that if Jesus is going to take this man who interrupts his teaching time, and then he focuses in by telling a story about a rich man. A rich man who he says, today, fool, your life is mine. And I think it's really interesting if you go back to what he says, and let me find this in my notes. God says, you fool, this very night, your soul is required of you. And now, who will own what you have prepared? Isn't that fascinating? I mean, one day we're going to leave this wonderful earth, and we're all going to go out, whether in a wooden casket or in an urn or, you know, in a nice, beautiful $5,000 coffin. We're going to go out in this world, and we're not going to go with anything. Everything is going to be left to somebody else to enjoy. So if that's the case, don't spend your life accumulating things that in the end, it's going to go away. But instead, focus your life on making much of God. Beware and be on your guard against every form of greed, for not even one, when one has abundance, does life consist of his possessions. Would you pray with me? Father, we're thankful that you have loved us enough to give us these stories from Jesus that tell us how to live our lives in a way that honors and glorifies you. Father, sometimes even I struggle with greed, and I'll be the first to admit it. It's these longings that, Lord, at times that I have in my heart, and Lord, you see that very clearly, that there's times that I'm not content where you have me. And Father, I continue to pray for me that, Lord, that you would begin to continue to work on that heart issue as well. I also pray for my brothers and sisters in Christ that, Lord, that they also struggle with the things I struggle with in life, that God, that you would minister to them in their soul. Help us to be men and women who are faithful to you at all costs. Help us, Lord, to be men and women who are generous to others, and whether it's people that we know and love that are related to us, whether it be strangers like Adeline and foster kids in Springfield, Missouri, or people around the world who have yet to hear the gospel who are in need tonight, Lord. May we just be men and women who are more than generous for your kingdom's sake, for your kingdom purpose. And may our hearts truly be that filled with awe and wonder of you, the one who gives us good things. God, we're grateful that we can focus and fix our faith on you, the unmovable rock, the one who never disappoints, and that is you. It's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen. Will you stand to your feet and join Lance and the worship team as we sing this last song?
Hey, man. Gosh, I love this series. And one of the things I love about this series that we're doing, Once Upon a Time, is because it just reminds me that, you know, our life is a story. And we do have a chance to help write that story. And, you know, what if part of our story in our life was once upon a time, there was a man, there was a woman who didn't live their life based on the possessions they had, or their life wasn't about them, but it was based on glorifying God and the generosity they had towards God. And I bet you that story would probably end and they lived happily ever after. And that's why I love this series. So come back next week. We'll continue the series next week. Thank you, Pastor Dave, for a powerful word. Couple of people I want to introduce you to, and no, we don't always just introduce guests with us, but we have a couple of special little guests with us, a young man and a young lady today. Lance, someone over there is kind of new to your family.
Yeah, Leo Matthew Kaufman.
Sarah, raise your hand there if you can. There we go. And then Jake and Stephanie. There's a new person in your being over there. Little Ruby, is that correct? Ruby Jean. So congratulations, you guys. And everybody at once, after you're done, just kind of go over by them, surround them with all your germs, and hold them and touch them and all that good stuff. I'm sure they'll appreciate that. So, hey, God bless. I hope you've been blessed today, and have a wonderful, wonderful week.